Good morning. I'm Joanne Myers, and on behalf of the Carnegie Council, I'd like to thank you all for beginning your day with us. We are delighted to welcome Rob Ryman to this Public Affairs Program. He will be discussing the ideas put forward in his book, To Fight Against This Age, on Fascism and Humanism. Rob is based in the Netherlands and is the founder of the Nexus Institute, excuse me, an international center devoted to intellectual reflection and to inspiring Western cultural and philosophical debate. His book, To Fight Against This Age, on Fascism and Humanism, comes at exactly the right moment. The omens are not good. For some time now, we've been witnessing the gradual erosion of longstanding moral values, both in Europe and in America, a slow and steady weakening of critical institutions, a dismantling of what has been built rather than creating something new. Debate is discouraged and loyalty demanded. As democracies around the world are beleaguered with threats from multiple sources, the question is how to meet and overcome these challenges. The answers may be found in a close reading of To Fight Against This Age. It is as timely as it is timeless. In two compelling essays, our speaker warns about the global resurgence of fascism and explores its weaknesses, which he says are so often disguised by false promises of freedom and greatness. In the second essay, Mr. Ryman articulates ways to resist the perils of fascist ideology and draws upon his vast knowledge of history and philosophy to issue a humanist appeal. It is an argument that makes the case for a return to enlightened values, emphasizing truth and justice, values that he posits are the origin and basis of a democratic civilization. At a time when profound transformations are taking place in public discourse around the world, please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our guest, who in To Fight Against This Age reminds us of what should be of value and importance at this time. Rob Ryman, thank you so much for coming.
Hey, Joanne, thank you so much for this very gracious introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here early hour. I know it's a kind of American habit, you know, the power breakfast. For us Europeans, it's still a relatively new phenomenon, but I'm very happy to see all of you here. Downtown New York, only a week ago, I saw a billboard with just two lines. The first line was, it won't happen to us, and below, this is not an emergency plan. And I thought, this is brilliant. It won't happen to us. This is not an emergency plan. And it reminded me of this brilliant novel of Sinclair Lewis in 1935, It Can't Happen to Us, which, as you recollect, was, you know, this satire on that he imagines that Franklin Roosevelt will lose the election to his character Winthrop, who will create in America a kind of plutocratic totalitarian state, not unlike what is happening at that time in Nazi Germany. The difference between this Winthrop figure and Hitler is that Hitler is an ideologue, but this Winthrop, maybe he's a con man, he's a manipulator, he has no ideology like Hitler. Now, the story in real life, of course, was much more hopeful. Franklin Roosevelt won the elections. He could stand up against, quote unquote, the plot against America. And mainly due to him, in 1945, fascist Europe was defeated. Forever. Forever. Now, that was the question which haunted a young French novelist, intellectual, who in March 1946 came to New York. And he was young. He had only published one novel, but there was already a buzz around him. I'm talking about Albert Camus, who wrote his book, L'Étranger, The Stranger. And that's the kind of novel which, you know, tries to explain, you know, how absurd life is, how meaningless it is, you know, given all the things that had happened in Europe. So 3 days after his arrival at Columbia, the Miller Theater, he would give a talk. And normally you can, well, I think around 700 stage of places, and there were more than 1,200 students coming to listen to Albert Camus. Those who expected Camus to talk more about how absurd life is, how meaningless it is, probably we would have been very surprised. We don't have the lecture, we only have notes of what Camus then said at March 1946. But based on the notes, we know that he said the following. "My generation in Europe," told Camus, "was born at the beginning of World War I. We were adolescents at the time of the Great Depression, and a few years later, the rise of Hitler in Germany, civil war in Spain, and in 1938, the betrayal of Munich. And then Second World War, Hitler in our country. Born and bred in such a world, what is it that we could believe in? In nothing. The world in which we were called to exist was an absurd world with no place to find reviews because the world of culture was too beautiful to be true. And so when we had to face Hitler and his Nazis, which values could we oppose to him? None. None, because what we were facing was much worse than the bankruptcy of a political system. This fascism came from the root of our society, which was fundamentally a society deprived of any moral and spiritual values. The violence of fascism was just its logical consequence. Yet, this fascist society, we had to fight it. And we did. But now Hitler is gone. We know one thing for certain. The poison of fascism has not been eliminated at all. It still exists. More than that, it is still present in each of us, who still thinks in terms of power, efficiency, and historical task in which ordinary people are sacrificed for a political goal. And a year later, 1947, Camus publishes his very brilliant novel, La Peste, The Plague, to tell us that fascism will never be defeated forever. Fascism, he wants his readers to understand, is like a bacillus, a virus that never dies and never disappears for good, as it can and will come back to destroy a democracy from inside. That same year, another German who find a place here in this country, Thomas Mann. Thomas Mann, who came here in 1938 and was well connected, he was very much befriended with the mother of Catherine Graham, Agnes Meyer. Due to her, he could give lectures at the Library of Congress. He was befriended with Roosevelt, was probably the last European who could spend weeks in the White House at the invitation of the president. But anyway, in 1947, he gives a lecture and he says, he makes the same point. He said, the war is over, but please don't make the mistake. Fascism did not disappear. It is not over. It can and will come back. Why? Why? Well, again, before the war, in 1938, when he arrived here, and which turned out, you know, the beginning of his exile, he came with a very important lecture called The Coming Victory of Democracy. And it was a coast-to-coast lecture from here to San Francisco, 40 town halls with thousands of Americans, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 6,000, literally people to listen to a lecture of more than 2 hours. And then he makes the following argument. He says, look, in my hometown, Munich, I have witnessed the rise of Hitler. I was living there, he was living there. And I have seen how a fascist movement came to power all over Europe. He had seen how the spirit of democracy can disappear in a mass society where demagogues are welcomed with the politics of resentment, the incitement of anger and fear, xenophobia, the need for scapegoats, and its hatred of the life of the mind. And so with this experience, he wanted the Americans to understand what democracy is really all about. And he says, look, what I got to learn, what I got to know is that democracy is, quote unquote, that form of government and society which is inspired above every other with the feeling and consciousness of the dignity of man. And he says, well, these are big words, and I'm very well aware of how petty we can be, that we are all can be the victims of, you know, our own egotism and cruelty and stupidity, etc. But precisely for that reason, he urged us never to forget that the great and honorable in men manifest themselves as art and science, a passion for truth, the creation of beauty, and the idea of justice. And these are the things a true democracy will cultivate, because it wants to be that form of government that attempts to elevate human beings and to enable them to think critically and to be free. Now, let's be honest, okay? This is not our democracy. Instead of equal chances and equal rights, there is a growing inequality and exclusion. Instead of elevating people, there is the ongoing dumping down everywhere. Instead of the cultivation of universal moral and spiritual values, we cultivate mainly the values of the commercial world. Productivity, efficiency, quantity, usefulness, and an aggressive materialism that dominates the whole society. Our commercial culture has no interest in reason, truth, beauty, and justice. It only activates our lowest instincts. And instead of compassion, there is resentment, there is racism, there is fear, and there is hatred. And instead of a serious political, intellectual discussion about the way forward to create a better society together, there is nothing more than tribal politics, Twitter slogans, propaganda, and image building. Now, crucial to understand that the true spirit of our society is a society of kitsch. Now, in general, people think that kitsch is just bad art, but that's a mistake. Kitsch is the mindset of a society that has given up on the cultivation of moral and spiritual values. And so at its core, a kitsch culture is completely meaningless. Yet all of this remains concealed behind the cultivation, even the idolatry, of our basic instincts and desires, as they have to fill the spiritual void. So how does a kitsch society, how does it look like, you know, in practice? Well, in a kitsch society, our identity is no longer based on who I am, but what I have. And our constant compulsion to buy and to possess is therefore not much a manifestation of greed, as it is this deep longing to have an identity and then to show it off to many people as possible, and with the expectation and hope that they will like you, right? The likes are becoming very, very important. The life of the mind in a kitsch society is no longer relevant. It's all about feeling good. And you'll feel best if everything is nice and therefore pleasant. So pleasant will become the absolute measure of everything you spend your time on. Your work, your relationship, what you do in leisure time, and at the very mad moment, you know, that you're no longer feeling very happy, there is Ritalin or other drugs. The use of Ritalin in this society is already above 25% among youngsters. In this, with pleasant, that everything has to be pleasant, religion, for example, will no longer be the call to change your life and to have compassion with your fellow human beings. But it will become the indulgence in self-righteousness and higher feelings. And Mr. Ray Moore and Mr. Steve Bannon are prime examples of this kitsch religion. Another crucial consequence is that the quest for quality, which is a spiritual value, will be replaced by the longing for quantity. So everything has to be big. And in the kitsch world, the best is, by definition, the biggest number. But there's always a bigger number. So it will never be enough. Now, combine the dominance of materialism with the faith in quantity, and you understand why in this kitsch society, we will always idealize the desire to be rich and the rich as being the true heroes of our time. And in this respect, it is only logic that education in that kitsch world is reduced to an instrument for the transfer of everything useful and knowledge that is usable for the economy and everything you need to know in order to earn money. emotions and irrationalism will prevail because reason and the act of thinking makes life too complicated. And in the kids' culture, nothing is allowed that is difficult because everything has to be fun, easy, cool, hip, sexy, entertaining. And in such a society, you can wait for the king of kids, whom his followers believe as to be the new messiah who will cure society of all evils and make them happy again and the country great again. Now, Europe and the USA have two different histories, right? Fascism has been part of our history for decades. And not only in Italy or in Germany, but in Spain, in France, in the Netherlands, in Central Europe, it was everywhere for decades. I presume that the USA, because of its own history, there is here a greater sensitivity for racism. But we Europeans have a greater sensitivity for fascism, again, because it has been part of our history for so long. And so Albert Camus and Thomas Mann, who both lived through the fascist era in Europe, were absolutely right. Fascism is a political phenomenon that will never disappear, as it is the dark side of every democracy. And so when our democracy degenerates into this kid society, whereby demagogues, stupidity, propaganda, vulgarity, and the lowest human instincts increase their dominance, that will inevitably give birth to that bastard child of democracy, which is fascism. Everything changes over time, okay? 2 years from now, 5 years from now, all of us will be different. And yet we are still the same. Now, it's the same with fascism. When it returns, it will be different from how we have seen it in the time of Mussolini and Hitler. And still, it will be the same. The fascist mindset in our time will not present itself in black uniforms or strange crosses or silly gestures. And of course, every fascist will deny to be a fascist, okay? But the character of the mindset of fascism will not have changed. And this is how you recognize it. Not by its ideology, because it doesn't have an ideology. This is one of the basic mistakes made by so many political scientists. It doesn't have an ideology. But the characteristics are always the same. So let me just mention a few. The new fascist leader will present himself, most of the time it will be a him, as the anti-politician, the strongman, the leader, who will cure society from all social evil. And knowing that that's not true, as the false messiah of a secular religion, he has no other choice than to deceive his millions of believers with slogans, the false promise of a return to a never-existing past, a rich and never-ending variety of enemies to exploit their resentment and fear, and last but not least, with endless propaganda to manipulate their habits and opinions. He has no other interest than self-interest, and his lack of ideas and vision will be hidden by blaming all kinds of scapegoats, and his disinterest in the rest of the world promoted as a brilliant strategy to make his own country great again. His worldview will be profoundly materialistic and favor extreme nationalism. He will be a pathological liar. They are all pathological liars. And his politics of lies underscores how right Thomas Mann was when in 1940 he gave a lecture in LA entitled War and Democracy, when he warned the audience, I quote, "Let me tell you the whole truth. If ever fascism should come to America, it will come in the name of freedom." The fascist leader, the fascist mindset, is always the mindset of an anti-democrat who despises the free press and prefers to make any judge he doesn't like suspect. And the habit to Twitter, indulging in name-calling, and avoid any serious intellectual debate is exemplary of the populist demagogue who despises the life of the mind and the spirit of democracy. He always will be the showman, the conman, who will exploit vulnerable people. And we got the most disgusting example of that 2 days ago at the State of the Union, were vulnerable people, like the parents of this Korean boy who was tortured, and the parents of the girls who were murdered by this gang. It was a fine example of political pornography. That's what it is. The fascist leader will demand an unconditional loyalty and his incapability to accept any form of criticism, plus his self-image of being a genius, always characterizes the authoritarian. Now, these characteristics of the quintessential fascist mindset are characteristics of Mr. Orban in Hungary, Putin in Russia, Erdogan in Turkey, Wilders in the Netherlands, Madame Le Pen in France, Kaczynski in Poland, Zeman in the Czech Republic, the fascist leaders in Austria, Germany, and last but not least, indeed, Mr. Donald Trump. Now, many people get it, but interestingly enough, many in the elites, the pundits, the academics, the politicians, remain in a state of denial. The F word is their biggest taboo, and they will not use it. What we get instead is a whole series of euphemism, populism, right-wing populism, and new words like Putinism, or Trumpism, or Trumpocracy. It's a big, big blind spot. And look, the blindness, just to give you one horrific example of how blind people can be, a great man like Winston Churchill, and God bless Winston Churchill. But on February 18, 1933, so Hitler was already in power in Nazi Germany. He gave a speech at the Anti-Socialist League in London, in which he said, quote unquote, "Mussolini is a great man, he's the genius of our time, he's a true lawgiver, and his fascism will be the strategy for our future." Quote unquote, Churchill, February 1933. It took him a few more years to understand what the real nature of fascism is. Okay, so I can understand the blindness, but it is dangerous as it is stupid. Look, I understand, we all understand that inconvenient truths are never welcome, not in your private life, not as a society. And the common response is natural. The common response is denial. No, this cannot be true. But as I said, it is as stupid as it is dangerous. Now, many of you will remember the Club of Rome, which was founded in 1968 and published their report on the limits of growth in 1972. And basically, it was the very first study of the consequences of an ongoing economic growth in our industrial society for our climate. And the general response in 1972 was denial. No, this cannot be true. You know, things are not that serious. Things will get better. Da-da-da-da-da. Well, we know what happened. And it took them decades to realize that the Club of Rome in 1972 was already right. And if they would have accepted that truth in 1972, our situation for the planet Earth would be much, much better. Now, it possibly is already too late. God knows. And the same thing is happening right now. And the key argument that there is no return of fascism and that Trump is not a fascist is he is not a Hitler. Well, yes, that's true. He's not a Hitler. But this is not relevant. There were many more fascists. And all argument, his actions are not violent. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you that his politics should not be compared with World War II. His politics should be compared with the time of its inception, the 20s. And you really does not need a PhD in psychology to understand that with his racist rhetoric, his divisiveness due to his politics of fear and hatred, he will incite, bit by bit, more and more violence in your own society and in the world, starting 2019, with this embassy going to Jerusalem. It will be a disaster. And the trouble with all those new words like Trumpism and Trumpocracy is that we are missing both the global and historical dimension of what is happening. And next to that, too much of all the books about what is happening right now inside the White House, which indeed within 1 year has been transformed into a hothouse of frauds and corruption and lies and propaganda. But it caters to the hunger of sensation, and it is a distraction from the true story. With all respect to Michael Wolff and his book, Fire and Fury, look, you can say a lot of things about Donald Trump, but not that he has ever been shy about the guy he is, right? I mean, so there's not that much new in this book. Well, okay, the ego of Steve Bannon is even bigger than that of Donald Trump, but we are missing, it's a distraction because we are missing the true story. And the true story is not what is happening in the White House, but what happened so that a man like Donald Trump could get into the White House. And probably the media are not focused on this because they are too complicit with getting the guy into the White House. The true story is not that Trump is the cause of the crisis of our democracy, but that he is an expression of our democracy in crisis. The true story is not that we are dealing with a political crisis, but with a moral crisis in our society. The true story is that our elites will not solve the crisis because their mindset is the crisis. This is very important, right? Elites in power have always an instinct, you know, to keep the status quo, because if the society really would change, they will lose their position. The true story is that we are no longer living in a true democracy because its spirit is gone and due to a deep defect in our culture. And because of that, we are now facing as a consequence that all over the West, with this return of fascism as the true anti-democratic spirit. Now, remember that billboard, right, which I saw downtown, it won't happen to us. That's not an emergency plan. Well, the return of fascism all over the West is now a fact. And so we are very much in need of an emergency plan to find an antidote to stop this early form of fascism to develop into something much, much worse. And the good news is there is already an emergency plan. It's here. Right? And so you read it, you think about it, you discuss it, you tell your friends to buy it, or if you're a good friend, you give it to them. And but as time is always an issue, I'll finish this talk with a very short handout. A few don'ts and one important to-do. The don'ts. Please stop the denial and be aware that those who continue to deny and keep on talking in terms of neologisms and euphemisms are all ignorant, or opportunistic, or fascist themselves. Two, fascism being the political expression of a defect in our culture is not something that can be fixed. So science and technology will not do. Three, we are confronting with a much bigger threat than an economic crisis. So stop thinking that with more economic growth, all will be fine. That will not be the case. Four, don't think that political activism is enough. Yes, hopefully in 2018, November, there will be already a change. Hopefully 2020 will be even a bigger change. But even with the disappearance of Trump and his gang, the bacillus of fascism will not have disappeared. So here's the to-do. Use the second chapter of this book to think and work together on a new counterculture. A counterculture in which there is no longer place for stupidity, in which there is no longer place for kitsch and conformism, but to have a counterculture that will educate us in the human capacity to transcend ourselves, to have imagination and empathy, to live in truth, to create beauty, and to do justice. And this is never easy. It has never been easy. But this is the true greatness of honoring the dignity of every human being. And this is what the democratic civilization is all about. And this is what already in 1938, Thomas Mann, here in America, called an education in the nobility of spirit, with its enduring call never to conform to the world as it is. but to be brave and accept your moral responsibility to fight against the return of fascism and the survival of the spirit of democracy. Thank you so much.
I thank you very much. I'm sure there are a lot of questions, a lot of ideas, and I just refer to Socrates, who says, I think, therefore I am. So that will open up the discussion. And when I call on you, would you just please stand up and identify yourself and try to keep your question brief and to the point?
Susan Gidelson. I think you have many people who would agree with your analysis sitting here. And there's one name I believe you didn't mention from Italy, Berlusconi has returned. But my question is, who are the leaders, if there are any, who would be more humanistic and who would somehow be able to overcome this growing fascism?
Well, thank you. Look, we are still living in democracy. One of the reasons that that my publisher published this book and that I gave these talks is that we are still not living in a police state like Russia or an even bigger police state like China. And I'm still allowed to speak, we are still here, we are still free. Now, in a democracy, it is we, the people. And we, the people, means that we are in charge of who will be our leaders. So we have to change first. We have to make sure that there will be what I mentioned, this new counterculture with people who understand what is going on, and they should be representing us. So, don't focus too much on the people who are now in charge, whether they are the Democrats or Republicans. Many of them are of a certain age. I don't see them changing their mindset all too long. And I could only have wished that, for example, the Clinton family would have devoted the last decade in training young people to become the new leaders of their party instead of putting themselves first. It's a thing that has to develop on all levels, right? The media, our cultural infrastructure, our education. So the change will come from bottom up. That always has been the case. So to have a new leadership means that at the root of our society, something has to change, and everybody can contribute to that and, quote unquote, make a small difference. But it will be a very important difference.
David Musher. Is this on? David Musher. Thank you for your comments. First of all, I always thought that values that we have as a society come from religion and from our Judeo-Christian background. You haven't talked about that at all. Number two, I always thought that a part of the definition of fascism was subservience of the individual to the state, and that fascism did not refer to any person or group of people with whom we disagree. I wondered if you'd comment on that, please.
Well, thank you. Concerning your first question, America is, as you know much better than I do, an extremely diverse society. People from all over the world are welcomed by your country with all kind of religious backgrounds. The reason that I on purpose choose to speak about humanism, which for me started with Socrates, and then we have had Petrarch, and then Erasmus, and Spinoza, and the Thomas Mann, and many, many others, is that it is an inclusive worldview which accepts the fact, and this is very important, the notion of transcendental values. And it has a focus on the dignity of man, of every human being. And out of it came a political view, which is called social democracy. And social democracy is that kind of government which takes as its prime objective that everything and everybody what is vulnerable in our society will be protected. Sick people, old people, people without any work, animals, the planet, that is what social democracy is all about. And so therefore you have to have a healthcare system, and you have to have pensions, etc., 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 and you protect the planet. Now, the notion of humanism is that it will tell us that our own identity is not based on our individual, how we are, but it is based on what we have in common. It's not an identity of what makes us different, but what we all have in common. It's a universal idea, and the universal idea is that everybody, whoever you are, can live in truth, can do justice, create beauty. And that, in practice, is not much different from the Jewish view that at the end of life, God will judge us by have we been a tzaddik, yes or no? Have we lived in justice, yes or no? Or the Christian view that is all about, you know, have you been a loving human being, yes or no? So the common identity is part of it. And if I refer to the notions of humanism, it's much more inclusive than when I talk about a specific set of values of a specific religion. In terms of the definition of fascism, I stressed the point that I'm talking about the political consequences of a society in which the democratic spirit disappears. Because again, this was the key thing of what Thomas Mann wanted to argue in 1938. He said, yes, I know, this is the country of Lincoln. This is the country of Whitman. This is the country where you have this great President Franklin Roosevelt. But let me tell you, I have seen how the institutions and all the pillars of a democracy will eventually disappear when the spirit of democracy is gone. It's like a marriage where there is no love anymore, okay? People are still together, but it cannot hold. So the spirit of democracy, that's the key thing. And when the spirit of democracy is replaced by an anti-spirit, the anti-spirit of democracy, that will develop over time into a form of fascism. And this form of fascism will indeed become, you know, that we all have to obey to the state. And this is where the authoritarianism comes in. Again, the fascism in Europe did not start as imposing fascism on the society. Camus and all the others, this was they made their argument. It will come from bottom up, and it will take time. It will take 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. But next to that, I can all recommend you, if you are interested in literature, please do read The Brothers Karamazov of Dostoevsky with the chapter on the legend of the Grand Inquisitor, where Dostoevsky, in the most marvelous way, explains how people are in fear of freedom. And if you're more interested in psychology and cultural criticism, please do read Erich Fromm, The Fear of Freedom, which one of the causes is the rise of fascism. And there is a lot of fear in this society, and there is also a lot of fear of freedom.
It's certainly true, I think we would all agree, that economic growth as such, particularly when the results of that economic growth are not fairly distributed, will not guarantee the return to democracy. But isn't it true that the absence of economic growth will probably ensure the triumph of fascism? It was only because in Weimar Germany, unemployment came up to about 33% that Hitler was successful. And it's probably true that Trump has been successful because he appeals to those people living in those parts of America that are in economic decline.
Well, you're absolutely right. Economics always plays a role. But again, if you look at the situation in Europe, because of our welfare system, there is much less inequality. We have a lot of problems, but there is much less social or economic inequality. And still, it happens in Hungary, Poland. I started to reflect on the return of fascism in my country when, and at the heydays of our economic boom in the 90s, recently got the forum of Mr. Pim Fortuyn. He then was shot, and not much later we got Mr. Geert Wilders. So the whole idea of that economics will solve it, that cannot be true for a variety of reasons, because A, in our democratic capitalist society, there will always be rich and poor. Some are very rich, and in a social democracy, some people will less poor, but the difference will always be, rich and poor. So a sense of, and when a society is hit by this crisis, again, this is what happened in Europe. They told the people over and over and over, Brussels, the EU is good because it's good for your economy. And then suddenly there was the financial crisis, man-made here, Wall Street not that long ago, and it hit our society. Millions of people got unemployed. Still, there was the welfare, but they got unemployed. And suddenly there was this fear, those people from Poland, from Bulgaria, to Romania, those Muslims, they're stealing our job, et cetera, et cetera. So it is, man does not live by bread alone. People are hungry for more than just materialism. And at the very moment where there is this fear of, you know, what is happening to us, and what is my identity, and who am I? And when they see that the world is changing and shifting, and they feel threatened for whatever reasons, if, again, the spirit of democracy is not there to protect our notion of civilization, then we get these things. Because, again, we are those beings with a double nature. We are the only beings with a double nature. On the one hand, our nature is that like animals, right? We are mortal, we have hunger, we have thirst, there is the sex drive, there is our aggression. We are like animals. But we also have a spirit. We are conscious of the fact that we are mortal. And we are conscious of our fears. And we are conscious of our frustrations. But we also know about truth, and we know about love, and we know about friendship. We know about these things. Now, civilization, as Freud will explain, is to be constantly aware of those values which we have to cultivate to make sure that the animal in us will not thrive and become dominant. And the danger of all forms of fascism is that it wants to cultivate our animal nature. It goes back to our basic instincts. That is the true danger. This is also the true danger of a commercial society. Now, the commercial society, in a certain way, is innocent because it only wants to make money with it, right? They give you all this crap. Because it caters to our sense of sensation, our lust for, you know, all the killing and all these things. But with but again, you know, it can get a political dimension, and then people can turn into animals. It happened, it's happening, and this was the main message of Primo Levi, that in the 80s, close to his death, he said, "Look, you know, it happened." And therefore, it can happen again, because human nature did not change. And he also said, look, it happened that a buffoon, you know, was welcomed and cherished by millions of people. Because even when the economy was growing in Nazi Germany, they didn't say farewell to Hitler. No, no, he only became, you know, more their savior of everything. And still, the hate was there. And still, the notion of we have to make Germany great again was there. And he invaded Vienna, and Austrians were welcoming him, millions. So again, don't, economics, very important. Please make sure that you get a kind of system which will make it possible that people will not starve, that people will have decent healthcare, et cetera, et cetera. But it's not the solution.
Ron Barenboim, I think that there's one person whom you didn't mention in your survey of Western civilization who maybe deserves a little attention here, and that gentleman is Hobbes. And I think that what Thomas Hobbes said was, in so many words, and the people who followed him in various different directions, like Locke, and our own constitutional founders, that men and women people need strong institutions to keep them safe and free. And in the United States, I think we've had, at least in my lifetime, which now spans nearly three quarters of a century, faith that our institutions would in the end help us work through our various issues. And now that faith, I think, is something that's being severely tested by people on all sides of the political spectrum. The same in the European Union, where they devised institutions that made them wealthy and improved the standard of living and provided a basic safety net, so to speak, but did not give those institutions the power to pass these benefits on in an equitable way. And the German people didn't so much fail in the 1930s as the Weimar Constitution failed them. And same thing in the UK right now with the deadlock imposed by their institutional structures. So their institutional structures just are not evolving to meet the challenges as they have so often in the past.
This is a very important point, and so thank you for much. But A, all institutions are man-made. And if Mr. Trump will have a second term, and if elderly people at your Supreme Court will not be healthy enough to go through seven more years, Mr. Trump, you'll get at least, you'll get a different Supreme Court. You'll get a different institution. You have here in America your institution of Congress, and everybody knows how dysfunctional it is because of its tribalism. So the point I want to make is that what is the true base of every institution in a democratic society? The true base of every institution is trust. Trust. Now, that is one of the things which no longer exists in our society. Trust is gone. Worse than that, common sense is also gone. So what you get is a society, sorry, Joanne, of lawyers, 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 right? Because everything has to be legal, legal, legal. But if something is legal, it doesn't mean it's good. There's an ontological difference between what is legal and moral good. Nazi Germany had endless rules, but they were not good. And so the other thing that next to lawyers, and because there is no trust in this society, America is a country with lawyers and shrink. And to get through life, you have to have your lawyer and you have to have your shrink. Basic trust is gone. And so that is not good enough to keep a society and institutions alive. The institutions can only function when there is a basic trust and there is a basic confidence in the society. Yes, we have those institutions, we can trust them, and they will do, you know, what is, they will focus on the common good. But the common good is another notion, which is gone. Again, what's happening here in America is also happening in Europe. The institutions of Brussels are completely dysfunctional. One of the reasons that they are dysfunctional is because they are only technocratic, bureaucratic things. There is no spirit, there is no soul in it. There is also no European consciousness. So it cannot function. And is this trust? Look, I mean, is there anybody who still have any trust in your political class? Nobody. Nobody. For good reasons. So, again, at the end of the day, it's our responsibility. Because we are the people. We are responsible for our own democracy. So we have to change first. And we can make better institutions, stronger institutions, get the best people in those institutions. But, you know, there's a lot of work to be done because these institutions are, again, not good enough to protect us from, you know, the things that can happen.
Thanks. Susan Bader, I would appreciate if you could speak about the rise of fascism today in the context of war. In the rise of the 40s, it led to World War. And today, we're seeing the drumbeat for war in North Korea. And from everything I've heard, Trump is eager to attack.
Well, again, the what a good questions. Fascism again is this political culture which thrives on crisis and hatred and resentment and scapegoats and so on and so forth. Given the fact that human nature did not change, that we are also those insecure people with our own fears and own frustrations and our own need for security and whatsoever, you do not, in such a period, you only need a spark. Now, a few sparks. World War I started with the murder of a crown prince, a silly crown prince, okay? And the whole thing exploded in Europe and nobody expected it. Nobody expected it. There's this wonderful book by Christopher Clark, The Sleepwalkers, which is a perfect description how the elites, blinded by what got us into, which got European ruins. The Balkans. With this ideology, you know, our tribe, our nation first, and you only needed a spark. In my first book, Nobility of Spirit, I start to tell the story of my friendship with the daughter of Thomas Mann, Elisabeth Mann Borghese, who, by the way, was the godmother of the environmental movement. She was the first. And she told us that when she was with her father and mother on holidays in 1933, in Swiss, and then Hitler came to power and they realized we cannot go back. But you know, she was a high school girl and Hitler, yeah, he was the democratically chosen leader of the country. So she just took the train from St. Moritz and went back to Munich. And then she got to know, she became aware of the fact that her girlfriends who 2 weeks ago were still in awe of a teacher whom they all loved already for a whole year because he was such a magnificent teacher, they started to hate him because he was against Hitler. And she told me it only takes 2 weeks. It only takes 2 weeks before your best friends, your best neighbors can become your worst enemies. I still have to read it, but Omer Bartov, an Israeli historian, just wrote a fascinating book on what happened in a village in the Ukraine, where the best friends started to kill each other. So again, this killing nature is in us. Now, on the sparks, look, if Trump and the others know their classics, and Putin knows his classics, okay? So Putin, to make sure that he could continue, he needed a war in the Ukraine, because he wanted to have his people behind our president, you know, because. So if they know their classics, if there's not a crisis, they will create a crisis. You still remember this funny movie, Whack the Dog? Well, that can happen in real time. And so, look, I mean, again, things can easily happen in the Middle East. Or, God forbid, there will be another terrorist attack in your country. Then what? You know, what is so dangerous is the cultivation of aggression. And the cultivation of us and we, so they and we. It is these things. Again, human nature did not change. And when you have a politics which is thriving on these things and which is in awe of, okay, you know, we have the military, we, you know, we are the stronger, the best. It can be North Korea, it can be Middle East, it can be an attack, it can be everything.
I'm a Turkish journalist, just fled the fascist regime of Erdogan, so fascinating talk. My question is, when I look at America, everybody's against Trump and they don't see that the real threat is fascism. And my fear for this country, because it happened in mine, it happens, like you said, more faster than ever, and the business and the elites, they're all complicit in it. Here, the focus is so much on Trump that they don't realize that the underlying is fascism. And I'm afraid this was just rehearsal, and Trump was like relatively a weak representative of fascism. A younger one is going to come after this one, a better articulate one, maybe a more handsome one, maybe a Harvard Yale, but with the same lines, because I keep hearing at Harvard Club, yeah, from my older mentors, they're like, yeah, he's very silly, but listen, Suna, some of the things that he's saying are like, you know, those policies are really there. So I feel like we're missing on the point. I think we're going to get rid of Trump, but we're not going to get rid of the fascist undercurrent there.
Well, you summarize in your comment my book. And so I can only wholeheartedly agree with you and again underline the following. What people seem to forget is, so we know about World War II, we know about Hitler and Mussolini, and we know what kind of monsters they are. Again, what we forget is that for 20 years ahead of this, they were welcomed, they were embraced. Not only Churchill was blinded, even a great man like Sigmund Freud dedicated the book to Mussolini. There was a whole lineup of artists and intellectuals who wanted to be Mussolini. The same thing we had with Stalin. I mean, so totalitarian powers has a huge, huge, huge temptation, especially for intellectuals, especially for academics. And so that's because it comes from bottom up, because it has a certain aesthetics, because it has this enormous charisma, because it gives us this idea of, you know, finally we can get rid of the bureaucracy and all these things, and finally a man or a woman who says how it is, but you know, we don't recognize what is going on. Well, everybody who has read this will open up his eyes and her eyes, and it's time to take action. Thank you.
And thank you for opening our eyes. Thank you.